some of these ones with a dark background, using either the black and white or the grayscale printout. You'll see you have that option when you print out PowerPoint. When I used to, we're trying to cut down on printing things out as a school. But when I used to print them out, what I prefer is the three slide view, because it gives you three slides on the left and then a place on the right to write, to take notes on. So the Pre-Socratics, obviously, they were not called the Pre-Socratics in Socrates and Plato's own day, but in retrospect, we refer to them as the Pre-Socratics. Sometimes it's hard to tell what's actually coming out. One, two. All right. Well. So at any rate, in retrospect, we call them the Pre-Socratics. And if you've read the chapter, you see that there are, and by the way, some of these. This was one that came with them, but some of these do have dark backgrounds, and it was kind of after I really did some of these that I realized, these aren't good with the dark backgrounds if you try to print them out, In other words, if you have an inkjet at home, you definitely don't want to print these things out with this dark black background, or you'll probably spend a cartridge on one PowerPoint. So anyway, so the Pre-Socratics, the earliest ones came from an island bordering Greece, or an area called Ionia, Miletus was the area. So we call them Miletians, Thales, Anaximander, and Anaximenes. And they not only were from the same area, but basically Anaximander was a pupil of Thales, and Anaximenes, who we're only going to mention, I should maybe put more of him in, because your book does cover him a bit. But Anaximenes was a pupil of Anaximander. And basically, what they were interested in more than anything was the issue of whether or not we could get at a theory of what exists that goes beyond just the prevailing wisdom, which is that there were four elements, earth, air, fire, and water, and they were in opposition in pairs to one another. If we had a deeper understanding of reality, could we do better than that? And they tried in their own way to do that. Now, what does the C mean before the dates? Pardon? That means what?
Century.
Good step at it. Anybody? Oh, what? Well, I just want to point out, since for a little word circa, which means around, approximately, that there's a lot about these folks that we don't know, and you know, so all of these dates are kind of inexact, and I'm not big on dates, you know. I mean, I'd like you to know approximately when these people lived. You know, you don't want to think that they lived in the Middle Ages, but you know, the dates themselves, you know, are approximate, and that's basically what the C means, approximately or around these dates. Now, one of the things that helps us date Thales is that he apparently predicted an eclipse that modern astronomers know happened in 585 BC, or BCE if you prefer. And, you know, so now when we say he predicted an eclipse, most of what I've read on this, it isn't, okay, if somebody predicts an eclipse nowadays, what they say, okay, now if you go out at 3:28 in the afternoon on this day, you'll see that the eclipse of the sun will begin, right? Well, it probably wasn't anything that close, you know, but maybe he got it within a few days, you know. So, now, a lot of, especially these early Ionians, a lot of what they wrote has been just absolutely lost. What we have are literally fragments, maybe of papyrus, as your book points out, sometimes in rock. Well, more of their works were around when Aristotle lived, and Aristotle, interested in scientific topics as he was, tried to study some of the views of the Pre-Socratics. So a lot of what we have comes down secondhand from Aristotle. You know, and many of their works then have been lost to history, and the only thing that remains are little fragments. So we have a quotation here and there, and Aristotle, for the most part, paraphrases them. Well, look, at the University of Virginia, remember I said we used to have students read some basic works in philosophy, short works from the original philosophers, like Plato's Dialogue, the Meno was one of them, from which that scene came in the video. We almost never have first-year students read Aristotle. Why? Because we don't think that Aristotle's actual writings are, survive at all. We think that what we have are detailed lecture notes taken by his students. And so here we have Aristotle summarizing the views of the Pre-Socratics in what has come down to us as basically the lecture notes of his students on the subject. You know, so we don't have a lot of information about them, you know, so there definitely is room for disagreement among experts as to what these people thought, you know. So at any rate, there's kind of two sources that we have then for knowing that they existed and that they lived and what they said. There are things like Aristotle's paraphrases of their views, and
and sometimes direct direct examples of their views. This thing should be peaking, but it's not. Yeah, feeding back. Oh well. Well, one of,
remember I said there were
a number of ways. There's no one way to teach an introduction to philosophy course, right? And one way that was popular, especially in like the 19th and early 20th century, but that sort of fell out of vogue for a number of reasons that I won't get into, part of them having to do with the philosopher Wittgenstein's claims and those of his school that many of the traditional problems of philosophy were pseudo-problems, not real problems at all. But one way to teach an introduction of philosophy is, rather than teaching it historically or topically, is to use what used to be called a problems approach. That is, to to introduce philosophy by focusing on some of the main problems that philosophy has dealt with over its life. And one of the main problems was the problem of the one and the many. In other words, does something general exist, or are general things true? And so, if we look around, just look around this room or look around outside, and we say, well, what's the world made of? And of course, what our senses tell us is that it's made of many kinds of things, right? You know, the ground and the dirt out there is of a different composition than the grass and the pine needles I see and the wood in the trees that have lost their leaves. You know, and of course that's different from the asphalt. In other words, there are many kinds of things, but is there an underlying oneness? You know, would we, if we had a deeper understanding of reality, realize that what to our senses appears as many kinds of things can really be reduced to one kind of thing? This also sometimes is called reductionism. But, you know, so a lot of them were interested in this problem of the one and the many. There are other problems that philosophy has dealt with, the problem of universals, which we find in Plato, over the existence of whether forms exist, and we're going to look at that tomorrow. It was revived in the Middle Ages, you know, over the issue of whether what were called universals, universal essences of things, actually exist, or do they exist just as concepts, as names, but not in reality. You know, there's the problem of other minds. If the only thing we know is the contents of our own minds, well, if we have private access to what goes on in our own minds, I know I have a mind, but how do I know you have a mind? Well, only by analogy from your behavior. So, you know, how do we justify the existence of other minds? And of course, you know, the rest of you are sitting there in your seat saying, well, I know I have a mind, but I'm wondering about Morawski up there. when we look at Descartes, we're going to look at the mind-body problem. If we're a dual entity, an immaterial spirit in a material body. How is it if matter and spiritual substance are very different, how is it that they can causally interact in the way that we think that they do, right? I stub my toe, a bodily event, and it causes a mental event, having a pain. I have a thought, I believe I'm going to pull that chair out from where it is, and then that causes a bodily event. But how is it? So these were some of the traditional philosophical problems. So one way to approach the study of philosophy is just to focus on some of these problems that philosophy has perennially dealt with. And one of the most long-lasting is this problem of the one and the many. So Thales comes out with an answer that on the face of it, we can giggle at. We can say, okay, so he thought everything's water. Well, you know, when you think about it, though, if you're looking for a basic substance, water isn't a bad candidate, right? If you need a basic substance, if you're going to claim that everything is only one kind of thing, namely water, you need a substance that can take on many forms. And we know, even without scientific equipment, you know, water can be solid, liquid, and gaseous. And why not think it can take on other forms, you know, like rock or wood? Think about it. Anybody, have like a wood stove or one of these outdoor fireplaces, and sometimes you put a log in. If it's been snowing, you got a log from the wood pile, but it's still got some snow on it, you know, and you brush it off, but it's still, you put it in there and it's burning, but it's a little hard to tell when looking at what's coming out of that chimney, how much of what's coming out of there is smoke from the wood and how much is steam from the water that's evaporating, you know, from the wet log. And of course, you know, we have things like eating cucumbers, right? Aren't they something like 98% water or something, you know? So, I mean, so Thales takes a stab at it and thinks we can do better than just saying there are four basic elements. Really, there's only one basic element, water. And the other basic elements somehow are forms of water. Now, by the way, Thales is the answer to the trivia question, who was the first philosopher, at least in the Western tradition? Now, Aristotle also points out that Thales observed in living things that water is an essential nutrient for life, and he speculates that Thales may have chosen water as the primeval stuff, you know, for this reason, that it's needed by all life, you know. So it's not as bad a candidate as you think. Now, there are other claims that Thales makes, and your book points this out, that all, one of which is that all things are full of gods. So one way you can look at this is, well, he hasn't really broken away from the mythological tradition entirely. Yes, he's interested at explaining things in nature as being just forms of water, but he thinks all things are full of gods. Now, honestly, for years, I used to think of this as primitive animism, which you find even in some, remote, tribes. I mean, the view that everything is inhabited by spirits. You know, that what we think is just a dead stick might, you know, have a spirit in it, good or bad. And that's the way I used to take it. Now, remember, I said that I made these up from a pretty thick philosophical text. And one way more modern philosophers have looked at it is, well, maybe he's saying something like this. We don't need the outside agency of a god to explain why things happen in nature, that maybe there's a force inside of things that's like a god that is responsible for things happening the way they do. So, you know, maybe this is a stretch, but this is one way modern scholars tend to try to make sense of Thales, saying, well, maybe he meant that there's a causal principle inside things themselves, and you don't have to go outside of them and appeal to the external or to the agency of external deities to get at why things happen in nature, you know. So, again, this is an example of scholars trying to interpret things differently. You know, I mean, what did he mean? Well, you know, the point is we don't have a lot of what came down besides some of the basic quotes. But anyway, I mean, Thales is pretty straightforward and easy to understand. And we'll see, in the history of philosophy, very often you get disciples who really adopt a lot of the views of their, you know, their teachers. I mean, Plato adopts a lot of Socrates' views, though he may disagree with him some. Now, Aristotle disagreed with Plato on some fundamental things, which may be one reason why Aristotle, who was far and away Plato's most brilliant pupil, never succeeded him as the head of Plato's academy because of internal politics. There were some fundamental disagreements between Aristotle and Plato, and so Aristotle went and founded his own school of philosophy. But the point is, you get pupils who agree with their teachers, but in the history of philosophy, like John Stuart Mill defending utilitarianism as it was taught by Jeremy Bentham. But you also get pupils who disagree with their teacher. Now, Anaximander rejected the four element theory, but and he rejected the claim that one of these four substances is the principal substance, because he thought, for one thing, some of these are paired as opposites, and how do you get the opposite from something that's so opposed to it? So they can't. He didn't understand how something can turn into its opposite. But he also thought that if everything were one type of substance, say water, then everything would be obviously water by now. That in other words, if one of these four elements were dominant, that it would basically take over and everything would be obviously earth or obviously air or fire or water, you know. So what is he saying? So he's saying things can't be one of these four, which of course means that they can't all be water, like Thales, his teacher, thought. Now,
basically, Anaximander thinks, and some people here think that he went, made a trip to Egypt. Mesopotamia. Now, I think he might have made the trip because some of his view of the ultimate substance, what he says is, what we need for an ultimate substance is something more basic than anything our senses can put us in touch with. Something more basic than earth, air, fire, and water. Something that's boundless and indefinite and unperceived. And he uses the Greek word epeiron, which we translate as boundless, indefinite, and unperceived. To refer to this substance. Okay. For some reason, the mic is not picking stuff up the way it should. That red thing means it's not picking anything up. Okay, I'm hoping that isn't feedback. Unfortunately, you can't hear how the audio is coming out on this thing. So at any rate, so Anaximander then looks towards something much deeper than the elements that our senses put us in touch with, or say our fire, water. And he calls this the boundless, the indefinite, the epeiron. And it's very similar to the idea that you get in Egyptian and Mesopotamian creation myths. And Bertrand Russell, in his History of Philosophy, says the epeiron is more like a sea of being or existence out of which everything comes. And that's very similar to the assumption that you get in basic Egyptian and Mesopotamian creation myths, that everything comes out of a sort of primordial sea of existence. And this is one of the assumptions that underlie sympathetic magic. The idea is that not only do we come out of that primordial sea of existence, but so do the gods. So if we can find out some of the deep secrets, you know, contained in this sea of being, we can use sympathetic magic to control even the gods using that. So he may have been influenced by some of these views, but there's no way we know for sure. But as I mentioned, these elements were thought of as paired in opposites, right? Water and air. Now we're hoping that the air dries up the water so that by the time we get freezing temperatures, we don't get black ice on the roads because the roads are dry. You know, so air and water, the wet and the dry, were thought to be in opposition to one another. And likewise, so, you know, fire, which is hot, and earth, which is cold, were thought of as being a sort of eternal opposition. So again, the fact that these are paired as opposites makes Anaximander think, well you're not going to have one thing turn into its opposite, you know, and so you need something more basic, and they knew that opposites tend to cancel each other out, not turn into one another, you know, and so and also this is what lies behind this idea that if one thing were dominant, it would cancel the others out and just take over.
So everything would be obviously water. Yeah, go ahead.
Is that hot or fire representing the sun?
Should I go back twice? Among other things, it is the sun. Yeah. He actually thought there were a sort of four-tiered layer, and they thought that there was an outer layer of fire around the whole universe. And that things like the stars are just light pricks. Yeah, you know, like what happens with a planetarium. You know, you've got light behind things, and you've got holes in, where the stars would be in the constellation, and the light behind shines through the holes, and we see what look like, you know, stars in the planetarium. Well, this is the way he thought the whole universe worked, that there's an outer layer of fire, but there's a covering. And I would imagine he thought that the sun was part of, was an area where this outer layer of fire really shines through. Now, Plato uses the sun to stand metaphorically for his highest form, the form of goodness in and of itself. He means the sun, but I think he means like a fiery outer layer of which the sun and the stars are evidence of that outer layer, because there are holes in, you know, the covering that separates us from it. I'm not going to go into this. This was something that was discussed in the text, but has no beginning, but is a beginning. But you do get this idea that ultimate reality, should be eternal. Now, here we go to the vortex. We supposedly have a polar vortex. Now, again, this is just for, PowerPoint purposes. He didn't literally think it was a funnel. But it's more like if, from the standpoint of us on Earth, everything is revolving around us, right? So it looks like the whole of reality is in a constant, vortex. And that's more what he's thinking. In other words, your book says, and here's where I guess the experts tend to have different interpretations. Your book says there was some singular destructive event that explosively separated out the elements. Where was that? On page 17, Anaximander seems to imagine the boundless as originally moving effortlessly in a great cosmic vortex that was interrupted by some disaster, like a Big Bang, and that disaster caused opposites, dry and wet, cold and hot, to separate off from the vortex and to appear to us not only as qualities but as the four basic elements. So the interpretation you get in your book is that there was some cosmic event that separated out, in other words, from this indefinite mass, it separated out four identifiable elements. I kind of like the story that is represented here that they told in this textbook, and that's the thought that if you take like a centrifuge, you could get different layers of things depending on their density, and that the motion of the vortex was itself responsible for separating out the elements. So not all in one thing, but so all things are present in the apeiron, in the boundless, but how are they differentiated? But their claim is that he seemed to think that the vortex motion separates out the elements much as things would be in something like a centrifuge. So the vortex separates out the elements. And he does come out, and here's what's relevant to your question, a view of the universe with the elements having different positions in the universe relative to their respective densities. In other words, the densest thing, Earth, or the Earth, everybody knows the Earth is at the center of the universe. You know, the Earth is there, followed by air. I'm sorry, followed by water, right? Right? And you know, obviously they knew the seas on the Earth and stuff. But then a layer of air surrounding us, and finally an outer layer of fire, which they thought was partially hidden from us by like a covering over the whole universe, and so that the stars tend to be visible parts of this fiery layer showing through the opaque covering, which I suppose was his explanation for the sun. So I don't know, you know, why is the sun so different from the other pinprick stars, you know, and moon? I'm not sure what explanation they would have given for the difference, and the idea that the gods somehow live on Mount Olympus, which was a volcano, right? I mean, you can see that chimes in with this theory because that's up close to the fiery layer. You even see the fire coming up. And so in the fiery layer, that's also where the gods were thought to exist. So why not at the top of a volcanic mountain? You know, not trying to change anybody's, whole religious views. Say, wow, you know, you're right. I think I'm going to accept the Greek pantheon. I didn't realize they were real. You know, we're not trying to make converts here. But I mean, what I'm trying to say, though, is, I mean, some of this stuff ties together very commonsensically and logically, you know, when you think about it. Well, I think now would be a good time, but let's take like 15 minutes or 20 minutes, and then we'll look at two philosophers who held absolutely opposing views of the nature of reality, Heraclitus holding that everything changes, and Parmenides holding that nothing changes. And the thing is, their views are not just of historical significance, but they influence later philosophers in various ways. Both of them did. So we'll look a little bit at Heraclitus and Parmenides. We're not looking at all the Pre-Socratics, Anaximander went back to thinking that everything was one of the big four, and he picked air. But he also gives a story about how he thinks that everything can be ultimately air, having to do with condensation and rarefaction. And so the other elements tend to be, on Anaximander's view, different stages of condensed air. But we at least want to get an idea of the flavor, what was going on back here at the heart of philosophy, of the dawn of philosophy. Okay, if anybody came in after I called roll, let me know that you're here. And let's take about, what time do we have?
10:43.
Well, okay, it's around 11. Okay, that's about... 17, 18 minutes. Take it off here. See, now notice we get
right
some audio there.
Go ahead and pause it. See, it should be picking up.
Yeah.
But it's also
I think it is. But most of the time you can see it peak a little bit better. That's quite true.
Now, we'll turn down.
One, two.
Yeah, because now it should be able to pick you up pretty easily.
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah, all right. Now I can see it peaking more or less the way it should.
Yeah.
Okay.
What it is with it turned up all the way because of...
pretty generous in the way I grade the oral presentation. Okay, well, let's look at it. Heraclitus, of course, is famous for the saying that you can't step in the same river twice. Why? Well, everything is in what?
Constant
change, yeah. So no matter how fast you put your foot in there a second time, it will have changed. And then I think it was your book that said, well, and also you might not even be the same person. I don't know how far he said that, but certainly the idea is that if everything is in constant flux and change, that there's a sense in which you can't step into the same river twice. But there were rivers around with names in Heraclitus' day. And so he knew that there was a sense in which if I said, well, okay, you say maybe this spring you'd like to go tubing down the Gunpowder River. Oh, well, when I was college age, we used to tube down the Gunpowder, too. And that there's a sense in which the Gunpowder River that we went tubing in is the same Gunpowder River that you would go tubing in this spring. I wouldn't recommend tubing today. But... and so we're going to see that for him there's a kind of an underlying unity, and here he brings in the word logos specifically, underlying the change that we see in things. The Greeks were fascinated with opposites. We already saw that, and you see it more in Heraclitus. Well, so one way you could look at his theory of reality is that it's illustrated by something like a river, and the waters are constantly changing. So you can never step twice then in the same waters. But since there's a oneness in difference
you can set twice in the same river. So a recurrent theme is that throughout change, a thing can preserve its identity as the same river. So he knew that there was a commonsensical way in which it makes sense to say that, you know, that the Gunpowder River that I went tubing in when I was in college is the same Gunpowder River that you can tube in, you know, this year. So there are some examples, and I think some of these are mentioned in your text, but these are actual examples he gives of this concept of an underlying unity in things, that even if there's a tension and a difference, that the same thing can have opposite qualities, right? The same pen can draw both a straight and a crooked line. Now we look at this stuff and it sounds trivial to us today. You know, we think, well, how could somebody have thought that that's some kind of an insight? But apparently it wasn't trivial, you know, to Heraclitus and people in his day to make these kinds of distinctions. He actually makes this distinction in one of the fragments that's preserved. And we have more from Heraclitus than I think other of the pre-Socratics. Another example of oneness and difference, that water can have opposite qualities, in that it can be healthy, you know, and amenable to fish, but unhealthy for us, you know, unless we have scuba gear on or something. So the same thing can have two opposite properties. And that, in other words, the idea that somehow the same thing can have two opposite properties, you know, just captured their imagination. And this is another example, that the same road can go up and go down. I used to commute. The first adjunct teaching job I ever had was at Women's Junior College, down about 6 miles from BMI Military Academy. And I used to drive over a mountain to get there from Charlottesville, called Apton Mountain. And sometimes things got a little dicey on top of Apton Mountain. I once came down one way when there was a 50 car pile up the other way. They actually had lights, even back then in the 80s, not just a line, a white line showing you the edge of the roadway, but actual embedded lights, you know, because the fog would get that bad. You know, but the idea that a road, like a road up a mountain, can go up and go down at the same time, just seemed a deep insight to them. You know, it may seem trivial to us today, but you know, they seem to be fascinated with this idea of the same thing having opposite qualities. Well, now here's a case where different interpreters disagree over what he meant. If we have four original basic elements, which reminds me of a group that was popular when I was in college called Earth, Wind, and Fire, and fire is one of those, well, you know, you do have this quote in your text, and your text is good at pointing out that interpreters disagree about these things, but that, you know, the basic principle of all things for him is fire.
one of Heraclitus' most famous aphorisms concerns fire. This is in the middle of page 29. He wrote, "There is an exchange of all things for fire, and a fire for all things." Many commentators understand Heraclitus to be naming fire as the basic stuff of reality. And so this is one way you can take him claiming, well, okay, he thought fire was the underlying element, just like Thales thought water was the underlying element, and Anaximander, who we didn't really study but mentioned, thought air was the underlying element. And that's one way you can interpret him. But another is that he uses fire as a metaphor for change. I mean, you know, sit in front of a fireplace, right? Look at flames, and they're, you know, bouncing around and constantly changing. Now, don't try this in front of a welding torch, or you'll get disappointed, right? The fire doesn't change. It's just one flue. But if you, you know, sit in front of a fire, it's constantly changing and shifting. And so another way of interpreting his use of fire is that he's using it merely as a metaphor for change, more than as a claim that fire is the basic element out of which everything is made. You get this point made in the same paragraph. Let's see. Others realized that Heraclitus was using the image of fire in a more subtle figurative sense. There is something about the nature of fire that gives insight into both appearance, the appearance of stability, the flames form a stable, and the fact of change in the flame. In the flame, everything changes. So I've always thought that the latter was probably, you know, the better interpretation there. But at any rate, realize that, you know, here's an area where the experts tend to disagree. And we don't have enough of the other things that he said to really solve the problem. You know, it isn't like a problem in something that a more contemporary philosopher said, where you can say, well, here's a quote, what does it mean? Well, let's look at the other 300 pages of the book that the quote has for evidence and what it means. Well, you know, there just isn't that opportunity for us, you know. But I've always thought taking the metaphorical way sounded a little bit better. So, is it the basic element for him? Well, as I say in the slide, maybe, maybe not. Could have been a metaphor for the world order. You know, the best word available to him. And this, you know, I mean, we can look at these people and say, well, you know, they didn't. Their theories aren't very much worth very much because most of them, you know, are wrong. But another way of looking at what they were doing is, for their time, they were pushing the envelope, and they were striving for conceptual ways to express their ideas when the words didn't really exist in their language for the concepts they really wanted to get out. And so maybe the best thing he had available was fire as a metaphor. At least that's one way of looking at things. And here we get back to this view that the outer layer is a fiery layer. You know, the gods of Mount Olympus live in this fiery outer layer. And so fire might have also been looked at as something everlasting and having a divine quality. You know, it's in the fiery outer layer where the gods live, you know, so there's something kind of divine. So as a substance, it might have priority as a metaphor for the world order's pattern, eternal and divine, but ever changing. And a lot of these people did think that the natural order was eternal. Even Plato and Socrates thought that. Now, here's something that I don't think your book goes into in quite the... There's an illustration on page 30 that hints at this view. War is father and king of all. Conflict is justice. Well, he seems to think that we need this constant tension of opposites in order to preserve the world order as it stands, that things in the world are a tension, or a strife between opposite forces. So if this solves for him the idea of the problem of the one and many, and in other words, a lyre produces tension on its strings, no tension, no music. Almost seems like in another life, but I used to do a lot of acoustic sets with the guitar and with various electronic things. But the idea is if you're trying to tune a guitar, if you're, say, replacing the strings, well, it's not until you get enough tension on the string are you going to get a sound at all. And so what is tension? You know, it's things pulling in opposite forces. So in order for music to exist, you need this tension of opposites on the strings. Likewise, a river, is contained within its banks, right? There's tension between the banks which want to contain the waters and the waters which would overflow the banks. So a river, and so its identity as a river is somehow defined by this tension of opposites. The river is in constant tension between the force of its waters and its containing banks, and so it's this opposition that gives it its identity as a river. You know, no opposition between the banks and containment of the water, no river. And likewise, you can talk about the existence of a statue and the fact that it needed to be brought about by tension, between the stone and the sculptor's chisel. So only through this tension is there a statue that exists. So he isn't just saying that everything's changing, but that a lot of things, there's a constant tension and give and take between opposite forces going on. And there's a quote, I think it's in the next slide, where he criticizes the mythological figure of Achilles. Now, maybe he thought that Achilles really lived, I don't know. But he criticizes Achilles. I mean, remember, this is Achilles the warrior. There's a movie on Achilles about 2 years ago. And here is Achilles, the warrior, saying, you know, oh, the, you know, strife and tension would cease from, you know, the world, that, you know, that we'd have peace, you know, the war-weary soldier. But Achilles says in wishing for strife and tension to cease, he didn't realize what he was asking for, because the view of Heraclitus is that the very existence of, you know, the world order depends on this constant strife and tension. So Achilles failed to see that in wishing for the strife and tension to go away, he was wishing for the destruction of the whole world order. So in Heraclitus, you get something a little bit deeper than just saying that everything's changing. Yeah. Uh-huh.
So wasn't Heraclitus that said that strife is a necessity, because he's criticizing?
Yeah. Right. So he's saying that Achilles was wrong in wanting strife to cease, because in wanting strife to cease, since, as you say, strife is a necessity for the maintenance of the world order, if you want strife to cease, you also are, in effect, wishing for the destruction of the world order. That's right. So it's a deeper view than just the view that everything is in constant change. And this unifying factor, he calls the logos, the principle by which, he says, all things come into being through strife and opposition in an ever-changing world order. As we said, the literal meaning of the Greek word logos is word, or a thought expressed in words. And so this book tries to say, well, you can look at it as the kind of thought or rationale that lies behind things the way they are. If you're getting out an explanation of things. So wisdom is somehow grasping the logos. And here wisdom is grasping this principle that everything is in constant change, but that there's a unifying order that consists of a tension between opposites. But I mean, not everything is paired as an opposite, right? In one of Plato's early dialogues, one that was written during Socrates' imprisonment, the dialogue is called the Phaedo. And remember, this is right before Socrates' execution. The whole dialogue deals with the idea of whether we might have some reason to believe that we continue to live after the body dies. And he considers one argument given for reincarnation, which is what Plato and Socrates both believed in, something that it was from Pythagoras that they got the view of reincarnation. I don't know. I tend to think it was around in Greek mythology. But at any rate, things have their opposites, and things change into their opposites and back again. And this is very similar to Heraclitus' view. And so the thought is that if death has its opposite life, so if there's a transitional period where somebody who's living dies, where life turns into its opposite death, then there must be the corresponding change of death coming back to life. And so he says, well, this is one reason for thinking that the soul becomes reincarnated in another body, that that these opposites have to occur in pairs, but it doesn't always work that way, does it? I mean, these things don't do real well, right? Even the more expensive ones. They keep stuff warm for a while, but this, you know, the hot coffee that was in here is no longer hot. Take my word for it. But the point is, if I set it here, the coffee in this cup is not going to just decide to spontaneously heat itself back up again because opposites have to constantly transform into their opposite state and back again. You know, the hot has to become cool, so then the cool should become hot again. Well, it just doesn't work that way, you know. So this view that you've got this constant change of things into their opposites and back again just doesn't seem to, no pun intended, to hold water, you know. And so Socrates' argument based on opposites is not that great an argument. But you can see the influence of a view like Heraclitus' view on an argument like that opposites have to, you know, change in their opposite and back again. Now look, I mean, I'm not asking you, like, I'm going to ask you the basics of some of these views, but not every little subtlety like we're going over them now. But yeah, go ahead.
Was Achilles after Socrates?
No. He would have been, way before. Achilles would have been a mythological figure that he held, that he knew about from what the poets had said, you know, but he was basically saying, he quotes Achilles. In other words, the text that I got this from, Heraclitus actually cites a quote from Achilles where Achilles wishes that all strife would cease from the earth, which is, you know, I mean, people say the people who hate war the most are the people who have to fight them, you know, the warriors. You know, it's similar, something like that, right? That Achilles, the war weary warrior, is saying, oh, that strife and war would, you know, cease from the earth, that we'd have some peace. And Heraclitus is saying, in wishing for all strife to go away, he didn't realize what he was wishing for. Achilles was actually, in a backwards, roundabout way, wishing for the destruction of the whole world because the existence of the world order depends on strife. So you wish the strife to go away, you also wish the world order to go away, was Heraclitus' point. Achilles would have been a figure in the distant past, even for somebody like Heraclitus. So at any rate, so wisdom is grasping the logos. Now, some of these people really did have ethical views. They weren't just interested in metaphysics. And we're not going to really, your book doesn't talk about his ethics at all. This larger book did. But it's interesting how even his ethics ties in with his metaphysical views. He says, knowledge of the logos implies moderation as the greatest virtue. And this was around, I think this was around in Greek society. We're going to see that when we look at Aristotle's virtue ethics, that he recommends moderation as the path to the happiest life and also the most virtuous life. That virtues occur when we moderate our behavior between extremes. And we find Socrates and Plato also arguing for moderation. And so he says, knowledge of the logos implies
moderation. In other words, if we just give in, right, you know, we get a thing full of chocolates for Christmas, and we say, well, just have that. But we give in totally to our desires and we eat the whole thing. Well, you know, immoderate fulfillment of our desires erases the tension. You know, we just gave in to it, right? We're not. Whereas moderate behavior opposes unbridled fulfillment of them. You know, saying, well, okay, you know, I'll have one or two, and then tomorrow or later on we'll have another one, but we want to be moderate in
attacking this box of chocolates. Well, if you want to be moderate, then there's some strife between what you'd like to do, which is eat the whole box of the things, or and what you have decided you're going to actually do, which is moderate your behavior, just eat one or two now and have more later. You know, so the idea is that ethical behavior is very often moderate behavior, you know. And we'll see this theme recurring. So, you know, I make basically the point I just made. The unlimited fulfillment of our desire for something like chocolate means we don't oppose it and, you know, can lead to bad things. So moderate behavior entails that we oppose overindulgence. That's actually chocolate, though you can't
notice it as much. Well, here's a, so, I mean, that's kind of all we're going to say about him right now, except that Heraclitus influenced Plato in Plato's views of the world, you know, and we'll see that next time when we look at the myth of the cave. I said that you ought to read that for tomorrow, too, because I don't think we're going to have that we're going to spend 3 hours on just a little bit on the Pre-Socratic, not the Pre-Socratics, but the Sophists. We're not going to spend 3 hours on sophistry and illusion, Hume says. Well, never mind. But he says.
I didn't let it out.
When we come across any book of, you know, religion or school metaphysics, he says, what habit must we play with it? Ask ourselves, does it contain any abstract reasoning concerning things like number? Does it contain any empirical knowledge that we can trace back to sense observations? And he says, if it doesn't, commit it then to the flames, for it can contain nothing but sophistry and illusion. So sophistry has become a name for bad reasoning and bad philosophy. Only some of these philosophers who were sophists have ended up with relativistic views that are closer to the views of many current philosophers than the views of Plato and Aristotle. So, and Socrates. So, well, that's a paraphrase of what Hume said in his first book. And he wanted to really make a controversial splash with it. But he was young and nobody knew who he was. And he wrote somebody later, he said the book was stillborn from the presses. Nobody paid any attention to it. He said, I couldn't even arouse any ire from the most strong religious zealots. Of course, later it was recognized as a masterful work in what it was. And And at the end of his life, he published, or he wrote a book that was so controversial, the Dialogues Concerning Natural Religion, that he wanted just the opposite of what he wanted at the beginning of his life. He said, look, I don't want to have to deal with a lot of objections to this controversial book. He said, you know, don't publish this thing till after I'm gone. And it was published posthumously. Three Dialogues. Three Dialogues. That was part of it, but Dialogues Concerning Natural Religion, where Hume tries to criticize some of the arguments for God's existence and raises the problem of evil and other things. And we're going to look a little bit at that. But sophistry, you know, has become synonymous with bad philosophy and bad argument in the history of philosophy. So we'll try to figure out why that's so next time a little bit. Well, here we have a view of a philosopher, Parmenides, that is the exact opposite of what we just said. Heraclitus says everything changes. Parmenides says nothing changes. Now, if you were going to look around yourself and you had to defend one of these from just looking around at the world, who seems closer to being right? Heraclitus. I mean, even rocks wear away eventually, right? I mean, you know, we have that problem with these Egyptian obelisks, who, you know, that were transported to Paris, put in the town square where all the acid rain and the exhaust and everything, and they're decomposing, you know. If we were going to look around for evidence from the senses, we'd have to say, well, certainly everything is in a constant state of change and flux, and the only difference is the rate of the change, which lets you know something about Parmenides' way of proceeding. Basically, Parmenides, and Bertrand Russell notes this in his History of Philosophy, he said that Parmenides might have been the first Western philosopher to use what we call an a priori argument, an argument based nothing on, on nothing but reasoning, on concepts alone. So, in other words, basically, what we're going to get from Parmenides is an abstract argument to the effect that nothing changes. And if your senses tell you something different, if your common sense tells you something different, his view is so much the worse for your senses and common sense. I'm going to rely on my abstract argument, and my abstract argument tells me that change does not really happen. So how does it get there? Well, it's a fairly complex argument. I use Bertrand Russell gives a very kind of a long restatement of it, because Russell was, besides a philosopher, first-rate logician and mathematician, and so he gives a lot of the steps. And I used to go through this argument in a much more detailed fashion. But we want to look at
at least the basics of this abstract reasoning that seems to have as its conclusion something that seems obviously at odds with our own experience and common sense, namely that things, the change does not happen, and that motion is impossible, motion being a form of change. This was one of the things that Zeno, his pupil, tried to point out. We'll look at one of Zeno's arguments if we have time. But at any rate, so Parmenides held that change is an illusion. In other words, he says, well, of course, your senses seem to tell you that things change, but that's an illusion. Ultimate reality is eternal and changeless. And this view that something that has the claim to ultimate reality needs to be somehow eternal and changeless is something that persists in philosophy in some ways, even down to the present day, but certainly through the rationalists. So only the one exists, that is, reality is one undifferentiated whole. There's no change because, you know, things don't go from one state of being to another. Now, we call these pre-Socratics, but your book rightly points out that there was some overlap. For some of the later pre-Socratics, they actually lived. Plato makes the claim that the aging Parmenides actually visited Socrates, so about 515 to 450 BC, we don't know, but again, if we take Plato's word from it, Socrates was visited by Parmenides at one point. Now, one of the claims he makes for the book that has come down to us, or at least most of the book, so we have a little bit more written by him than some of the other, is that his philosophy was revealed by a goddess. Now, we can take this with a grain of salt.
Are we talking about Plato right now, or
Parmenides? This is Parmenides. In other words, Plato just made the claim that Parmenides visited Socrates when Parmenides was an old man and Socrates was a young man at the time. We don't know for sure if that ever happened, but why not? You know, why would he make the claim if it didn't? Now, we mentioned before that a claim based on authority is not something that a lot of philosophers put much stock in. In other words, accept this as true on the basis of my authority or on the basis of the fact that it was given to me, inspired, that I channeled a goddess in writing it or something, you know. So you need to take what I've written as the truth, because would a goddess channel falsities? Well, you know, those kinds of claims that we ought to accept something purely on the basis of authority, are something that philosophers are trying to get away from. The idea is, what are the reasons you can give to support the views you have? But he also asks us, though, to judge the book by the reasoning he makes. So this is very much in the philosophical tradition.
And this is a key feature of philosophy, that we would judge the worth of a view or a belief by the reasons that can be given in support of it. And so we want to look at this abstract reasoning. And again, the word here is a priori. It actually should be underlined. And the way it's usually defined is prior to and independent of experience. In other words, to say that his supporting argument is a priori means that he's trying to argue strictly from logical concepts alone, that nothing changes. So how does he do this? How does he come to this view? Well, this is a view that Bertrand Russell struggled with himself, and he one of the most influential short essays in logic that was published in the early 20th century was Russell's theory of descriptions. And take a unicorn, for instance. Let's suppose they're mythical creatures. Now, I've heard something recently where people argue that there's a type of goat that may have actually been what they were referring to as unicorns, and you could have a living animal. But as we see them, let's suppose they don't exist. And so let's say we want to say something like a unicorn does not exist, or there are no unicorns. Well, what I'm trying to say is that the issue that Parmenides struggles with is something that even persisted into the 20th century. And that is, how do you refer to what does not exist? Okay? You know, the problem of referring to what does not exist without inadvertently assuming its existence. So if we say there are no unicorns, or a unicorn does not exist, does it sound like we're saying something like there is something, something, namely a unicorn, which is not in other words, how can we talk about unicorns without somehow assuming that they have to exist in order for us
to talk about them, that they need to be around in some way for us to talk about and refer to them intelligibly. And as I said, the title of Russell's article was called The Theory of Descriptions, and it's a fairly technical, logical article, but the bottom line is what he tries to say is, well, what you're actually talking about and all that really needs to exist is something like a description in words of what a unicorn is, but not a unicorn, you know. Hence the title for the article, The Theory of Descriptions, that we can talk about a unicorn and know what we're talking about without assuming in some way that a unicorn has to exist in order for us to refer to one. That all that needs to exist is something like a description in words of a unicorn. Now, this may not seem like a serious problem, but this is the same problem that Parmenides is working with. And he basically begins with the assumption that we cannot even think of what is not. We can't think of or refer to what does not exist. Now, I mentioned that I made a mistake of not completing my dissertation, but my dissertation advisor, Peter Heath, has an article where he opens it, and it's the Encyclopedia of Philosophy, the old Paul Edwards Encyclopedia, which is our library has, and it's the article on nothing, where he says, Parmenides starts his philosophy by saying that we can't refer to what does not exist, and then he goes on to break his own rule in the rest of what he says, because he goes on with a lengthy discussion about what does not exist. So, at any rate, but the problem here is, can we refer to what doesn't exist? And he says no. So thought and being existence are the same. So if we can think of something or talk about something, it must, in some sense, exist. So we can't refer to nothing. We can't even talk about it. So thinking of nothing or what it is not is impossible. It involves the same sort of contradiction as, say, squaring the circle. You know, in other words, that referring to what does not exist involves you in an impossible contradiction. And so the state of nothingness, of non-existence, is for him an impossible state of being. There is no state of non-existence. There is no thing, no such thing as nothing, in other words, for him, right? And we can't even refer to it. So if you get this much in mind, you can kind of see how his argument goes. I may even do it. How does he show that nothing changes? No pun intended, that there is no change. Well, one way of interpreting change is something's coming into or going out of existence, right? And this is, when you're discussing what exists in the world, this is the type of change you're most concerned with. Do things ever come into or go out of existence? And so he's got an argument that says you can't go either way. So according to Heraclitus, things constantly come into and go out of existence. According, you know, to Parmenides, this can never happen. But why? Try coming into existence. This is the way I used to like to do it on the blackboard. In other words, if our concept of change, because we're talking about what exists, if in saying that nothing changes, we're saying that nothing comes into or goes out of existence, then we need to show that this does not happen. And how do we show this? Well, to come into existence, it would need to pass from, you know, non-being or not being, or nothing, the state of nothingness, to, you know, existence or what exists, right? But, so, you know, but he's saying, look, nothing can come, you can't get something coming into existence from nothing, because this former state is self-contradictory and impossible. So in order to come into existence, being or matter would have to go from this impossible state into the current state of existing, which is an impossibility because it presupposes that you go from the self-contradiction. So claiming that something passes into being involves implying that it formerly was not, so it would need to pass from a state of not being or non-being or nothingness into a state of being, but the former state is supposedly inconceivable and impossible. Why? Because we can't even refer or even think about what is not. It's like thinking of a square circle. It's thinking of something that's impossible and self-contradictory. So, because this state is impossible, you can't have something coming into existence from non-being, right? So things cannot pass from not being or non-being into existence or being. So that's half the argument, right? In other words, half change is coming into existence from non-existence, and the other half of the coin is going out of existence, something that exists going out of existence entirely. Well, here again, passing out of being or existence would involve passing from a state of being into a state of non-being or not being. But again, the latter state is impossible. So you can't go from, you know, from an existing thing or existence to, you know, non-being or the state of nothing or nothingness, because again, you're passing from a possible state of affairs into this self-contradictory and impossible state. So
So the idea is that what exists must have always existed. It never came into existence, and it will also exist eternally. It will never go out of existence. And when you think of it, it's not too far from one of Newton's main laws, right? That matter isn't created or destroyed. It simply changes state. Now, I'm not saying it is. I'm saying, you know, it reminds us. Right. It's different. But so at any rate, the assumption then that there's a realm of non-being involves a contradiction. There can't be a state of nothingness, so things can't pass from being to not being. So do you see where this goes? So this abstract argument says, if change involves one of these transitions, but both of the transitions involve either coming from an impossible state or going to an impossible state, then neither transition can happen, and hence nothing can come into existence and nothing can go out of existence. Nothing in the sense of no existing thing, but that everything that exists is eternal and is one. It has to be one. You can't have diversity, because then you're saying something is not something else. You know, you bring in the concept of nothing again. So change would be impossible. There can be no change, since it would involve either coming into being or passing away, and either would entail movement from or to a state which is impossible, not being or non-being. So Heraclitus and our senses are wrong, and change is an illusion. So that's kind of where he comes at things. And some people think he's the first rationalist philosopher. In other words, one of the things we're going to see is this tension in philosophy between people who think that good philosophical views should be based in observations, like Hume, and if we can't base them in observations, they don't have a good foundation. And then there are other people, perhaps going all the way back to Parmenides, and certainly people like Plato and Socrates and Descartes are in this camp, the rationalist camp, that hold that reason gives us an end to reality, that even our senses don't put us in touch with, and it can lead us to conclusions that occasionally might contradict what our senses tell us. And of course, the point of view of this way of looking at things is, if my abstract argument tells me one thing and my senses tell me the opposite, so much the worse for what my senses tell me. You know, so arguments based on reason alone, apart from sense experience, you know, here in the slides I use the term a priori. And he, you know, other people, Russell and other people observe that he may have been the first philosopher to try to establish a conclusion about the nature of things, about how things are in the world, about reality, using concepts and nothing more than concepts, using an entirely abstract argument. You know, and so ultimate reality has to be eternal. You know, nothing can come into existence. All that exists must exist in an eternal present. There can't be a time that was not this time. And
Plato takes this and runs with it, we're going to see. And it's indivisible because if you have parts, then one part is not another part. Now here, again, it brings in this possible state of not being. Again, this is a little hard for me to, because you're not talking about a vacuum here. You're just talking about something that isn't something else. But this seems to have been his reasoning. So how do you solve the problem of the one and many? Well, reality is one and not many, and it's an eternally existing one. Let me just, it'll only take 2 minutes. I'm not going to test you on anything Zeno said, but Zeno's paradoxes try to show that motion, which is one type of change, really doesn't occur. And the idea, one of his arguments is what was called the dichotomy argument. Let me do it on the bottom of this. To dichotomize something is to cut it in two. Tome is the word for cut in Greek. Di, recognize, two. So the idea is take any theoretical distance, the distance between point A and point B. And of course, what the argument is trying to show you is that you can't traverse the distance between point A and point B. Why? Because, and here you need to think in geometry of the idea of there being an infinite number of points along this line. Well, now I'm just doing this by, estimating it. But you would have to traverse, to get from A to B, you'd have to traverse some midpoint between A and B, namely C, right? But of course, how are you going to get from A to C? Well, here you'd have to traverse a midpoint between A and C, namely D. Well, how are you going to get to D? Well, there's some midpoint between A and D, namely E. But you can see that you can make an infinite number of these divisions. And so the idea is you never can get from point A to B because you're always going infinitely through these. Now, of course, our senses tell us that that doesn't happen, that I can walk to the other side of the room. But here's a theoretical argument where if you assume that the distance between A and B is any distance, we're letting it represent any distance, it shows that for any distance you can't travel it. Now the solution, I'm told, by a mathematician friend of mine, is to be found in calculus, which shows you that an infinite number of points can nonetheless sum to a finite distance. And so even though you're going through an infinite number of geometric points, which remember don't have any widths, that's how you can have an infinite number of them, nonetheless you're traveling a finite distance, and you can travel a finite distance. But, it takes some high-powered mathematics to solve this age-old puzzle. This is one of Zeno's paradoxes. And it has messed up people's minds for quite some time. But Zeno was a disciple of Parmenides, and motion from point A to point B is just one type of change. So he's trying to show that this type of change, in principle, cannot occur. So. Okay, we'll start out things probably with the myth of the cave. I'm going to show part of a video that discusses that and discusses philosophy in general, and And we'll also look at Socrates and the Sophists next time.
Okay, thanks very much. We'll see you tomorrow. Be careful tonight if you're going out, because it's supposed to drop like really low after midnight. So, you know.
Thank you.
Take care.